Episode 1454, My Strength is My Story with Dr. Samantha Brody, Overcoming Overwhelm.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo.
Happy, happy day. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is my Strength is My Story series, and we have Dr. Samantha Brody, a naturopath, in the house with us today. We're chatting about overcoming overwhelm. I know it's only 3 days into the new year, and you're probably already feeling it. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Dr. Samantha's, welcome to our family. We're so delighted of your presence. If you already even had the opportunity, you want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple strategy, everyday solutions to live, love, and impact. Well, you're going to be impacted today, and maybe you're feeling it already because of overwhelm. Your resolutions are already beginning to, well, fall flat. You feel like you can't get everything done. The to-do list is growing. Well, guess what? Dr. Samantha is in the house, and she is here to help you. We talk about some crazy real-life circumstances, and we also talk about rats. Okay, that's for another episode, but no, really, we do talk about rats. Lots of giggles. I promise you, your heart will be warmed. And most importantly, your mind will be changed. The way you think about overwhelm and how you begin to approach change in your life. Without further ado, let's welcome in Dr. Samantha Brody, Overcoming Overwhelm. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I am so excited we have a doctor in the house. Oh yes, Dr. Samantha Brody. She is the wife of 14 years to her husband and mom to their 12-year-old son. She's a licensed naturopathic physician, an MD, and an acupuncturist, plus the owner and founder of Evergreen Natural Health Center in Portland, Oregon. Dr. Samantha earned her doctoral degree in 1996 and her Master of Science in Oriental Medicine in 2001 from the National University of Natural Medicine. She has spent over 20 years addressing the physical, mental, and emotional aspects of her 30,000 plus patients, helping them effectively address and achieve their health goals. In addition to her clinic, Dr. Samantha has a virtual practice across the globe. She's worked as a consultant on dietary supplements and product development for physicians and health food companies. She is also an international speaker, if she's not busy enough, and a brand new author of her new book, Overcoming Overwhelm, Dismantle Your Stress from the Inside Out. It's time to kick your new year off with less stress before overwhelm becomes you. How are you, Dr. Samantha?
Great. I'm so excited to be here today.
Oh, well, I am honored to have you here. I got an advanced copy of your book, so hot off the press here, so I read it online. I love that we can do this now, but, you know, it's kind of a new year, and I don't know about you, but, you know, overwhelm begins to set in before we even kick off 2 or 3 days. Let's start with this first. What brings joy to your heart?
You know, the thing that really brings joy to my house, that was an interesting little brain glitch. So I was actually going to say travel. So the thing that really makes me feel the most myself is when I'm on the road. And it's interesting that I said at my house, because when I'm traveling and taking time for myself and doing the, you know, making the effort to do something that lines up with my values, at home, things are better. And I'm happier, and I do better with my husband and my kid, and our overall life is uplifted by my taking the time to do something that lines up with my own values, which travel is the thing that is my primary.
Oh, well, that is fantastic. Most people hate to travel. I mean, they like the travel, but they hate the messiness that goes with the travel.
Yeah, you know, the way that I get around that, I have a hobby of what's called travel hacking. So I collect airline miles with my credit card purchases to be able to travel for free in business or first class and get free hotels. So it's, you know, without making any effort or spending any money, I get to travel in a way that's more relaxing because of that hobby I have.
Wow, that's a fantastic hobby. I can hear everybody right now, their ear going, tell me more about that part. We'll have to do another episode just to focus on that.
Yeah, whenever I was actually recently giving a talk at a conference, and I was in the elevator on the way down with some of the other speakers, and I started talking about it, and someone said, wow, you're really excited about that. Yes, I get really excited about it. It's actually fun. The process is fun, in addition to the traveling being fun. So I'm more than happy to talk to you about that anytime.
Oh, that would be fantastic. Because my ears would want to know. I'm a mom of five. And so anything you can do to save and find other ways to kind of hack into what's out there in the world, more power to us, right?
Yeah, great. Anytime, on air or off.
Fabulous. Well, where did your interest begin in medicine?
So when I was an undergraduate, I was studying psychology, and what I found is that a lot of the people I talked to who were in counseling weren't really getting, they were getting benefit out of the counseling, but it wasn't getting them where they wanted to get. In many cases, the kind of talking, and don't get me wrong, I'm a big proponent of counseling, but I learned about body-oriented counseling, and so I spent a summer studying massage. I was about 19. Studying massage geared toward helping people connect to emotions that were kind of locked in their bodies. And then from there, one of my teachers at that program in California was going to be starting naturopathic medical school. And so I came to it from the alternative health side rather than from the medical side. And I learned about the program and found that I could study medicine and do it from this kind of complementary and integrative perspective instead of a traditional Western, which really felt more in alignment with what my values were, even at that time as a young person.
People are very familiar with MDs and DOs, your traditional physicians. Some may not be as familiar with naturopathic doctors or NDs. Define naturopath for us.
So naturopathic physicians are trained, actually let me back up a second. There are naturopathic schools that don't set you up to be a physician. So there are online programs that are kind of holistic healing programs and holistic health training programs, but they're not actually programs that you can then sit for boards and become a licensed naturopathic physician in states where we're licensed. So the program that I went to is a traditional medical training program that also has integrative medicine taught as well. So I had my undergraduate, and then I had 2 years of pre-med, and then 4 years of naturopathic school, where we're trained the same way or very similarly to Western medical doctors and DOs in diagnosis and what labs to run and how to interpret them and, all of the same basic sciences. And then we didn't really have very many residencies. Now the kids graduating have more because this was 24 years ago when I started school.
You're just young.
I am. I was 11 when I started school. No. So the program then sets you up to practice as a naturopathic physician. In the state of Oregon, I'm a licensed primary care provider, or I am licensed with a primary care scope, I should say. So I do... I see people for everything under the sun, for high cholesterol, for headaches, for, anxiety or depression, and I can prescribe medications and refer to a specialist the same way a primary medical doctor would do. I can do annual exams and take care of people's medical needs, but my practice has a focus on not using Western medicine unless it's unless it is really necessary. So there are certainly times, if someone comes in and they have a staph infection, they're getting antibiotics. If someone comes in and their liver enzymes are really high, I'm sending them to a gastroenterologist, right? But often people will come in and say, yeah, I went to see my doctor for this, and they put me, for instance, I have PMS, my doctor put me on the birth control pill. I don't really want to be on hormones if I don't need to be. And I'll say, oh, great, let's look at your diet and supplements and lifestyle. And, 95% of the time, I can get things managed without having to go to medications. And that said, there are times where medications are really appropriate. So we're positioned in this way that we can do both. Now, there are some states where we're not licensed. So we don't have national licensure. It varies state over state, not only whether we're licensed, but what we can do with our license. So in Oregon, I can prescribe any drug except for chemotherapy drugs and a few atypical antipsychotics. If I were, say, in Tennessee and I tried to take someone's blood pressure, I could be arrested for practicing medicine without a license. So it's very odd that we have that. So my way around you know, my way to help people who are in states that aren't licensed is to do consulting and coaching online with them so they can get the benefit and the expertise of what I do without necessarily having me do diagnosis or run labs. And I'll say, hey, here's what I would do if you were sitting in front of me, and you can ask your doctor for this. And that's something I often will even do in my practice in Portland too, because I ask people to have a primary care physician as well. I don't act in that role because I'm not available on Friday night at 2. I don't have coverage, you know, all that. So what I will do is say, hey, here's how you can talk to your doctor about your concerns about being on this medication, and here's how you might want to ask for these particular tests, or you can order them yourself, and here are the ways that we can work together with your Western medical doctor or with your other approach or with whatever it is you're doing to make sure that your healthcare lines up with what is most important to you and what your own values are, because we each sit in a different place along the continuum of what we want for our own healthcare.
Yes, and it puts the healthcare, the power back into your hands and not leaving it into the insurer's hands.
Right, and in Oregon, I actually do bill insurance for 85% of my brick and mortar patients, and it is sometimes very challenging. Because of what I can and can't do and because of what they say. And some people choose to just pay out of pocket. Other people, we do our best to work around it. But it's definitely limiting, for sure.
Wow. Well, it's fascinating. And I think sometimes people, you know, they get this idea that, oh, it's alternative medicine. And then big question marks begin to fly in their head like, oh, maybe that's not something I should touch. But for some people, it really is beneficial. Who would you say is kind of like the key, you know, client that would need a naturopath in addition to their primary care physician?
You know, my honest answer is everyone, because everyone, I mean, even when people come in and say, yeah, my diet's great, we actually look at what they eat and it may not be right for them, for what their individual health needs are. And there's so much crazy conflicting information online. I mean, one of the things I was just talking to, I have a health forum on Facebook that I've just started to dig into to try to drive people there so I can answer their questions rather than having them post on a thread where they're like, you know, I have a headache, what should I do? And this stuff people are saying is so, you know, some of it's legit and some of it's just bonkers. You know, so what I really want is people to have access to legitimate kind of evidence-based, you know, complementary care. And so I do think that everyone can use it. Everyone can use help with their nutrition. Everyone needs some supplements. You know, sometimes it's just one or two, but there are always things that we need just because of the life that we live in. Most people are walking around with health issues that they're, you know, don't seem, you know, that their medical doctors aren't going to be able to take care of, or they don't want to take a medication, or they're tired of hearing you're just depressed, or of course you're tired, you have five kids, or, you know, whatever the thing is. It's not normal and it's not necessary. And so I get to work with people to figure out, well, what's most important, and, you know, what's important to you? What are your values? How do you want to feel? And do you feel that way? And if not, what's the path we need to take to get you there? Whether that's, again, supplements or lifestyle or nutrition or medication or, you know, other things that they as an individual will need to get to where they want to be with their health. Because so often I think we settle for less than. And I don't think we need to settle for less than. I think we deserve to feel really well. And when we feel well and when we have the energy we want and when we're not overwhelmed, we have the resources to do what we really want to do here with our lives, whatever that is, whether that's being a mother or a friend or in your profession or helping in the world in general. When we don't feel our best, we can't give what we want to give. So the answer is, you know, without being trite, the answer is pretty much everyone.
Well, that's awesome. And hopefully that will open some doors for some people, because they may be sitting there going, gosh, I've had all of these issues and I've gone to two or three specialists plus my primary care. And I know something's wrong, but everything, you know, I go in and my test scores say that I'm normal, but I know I'm not normal because this is where I'm at. So it is really good, I think, for the education side of it as to what works for you. There's not necessarily a negative or a positive. It's what works to that individual.
And I think it's really common for women in particular to be told there's nothing wrong, you're fine. We know that we're not, that there's something not right, right? And sometimes it's not even a terrible thing. Sometimes it's something simple like when you eat dairy, you get congested and feel tired. Or when you get 6.5 hours of sleep and say that's plenty, it isn't.
Yeah, we need more. Well, today we're celebrating. It's a new year. We're kicking off your book, and some people are already feeling overwhelmed. So to get us all on the same page, let's start with a basic definition. What in the heck is overwhelm? We feel it, but do we really know it?
Right. So what I would say is overwhelm is different for all of us. So for some people, overwhelm is going to manifest with literally a feeling of, oh my gosh, there's too much going on. Other people are going to manifest it as, you know, whatever their weak spot is, anxiety or depression or headaches or stomach aches or fatigue, you know, wherever it is that the individual has a disposition is where they're going to manifest overwhelm. And one of the things in my book that I talk about is that overwhelm isn't just about having too many things on your to-do list. It's about having a pile of things in your life that don't line up with what's actually most important to you. And we see that with the yes people, right? And the people pleasers. We also see that when people are, when people aren't making sure that they're being brutal about what it is that they're doing with their lives and cutting out things that aren't as important and identifying the things that we have control over that we can change. So a lot of times we really feel victim of our lives, right? Well, I have two jobs and, you know, I have two jobs and a crappy apartment and my boyfriend cheated on me, or, you know, whatever the things are where we really feel like we don't have a lot of control. And yes, there are many things we don't have control over. We don't have control over, you know, often if you don't have access to education or you don't have access, you know, or you have to work two jobs because, or three jobs because you have to get food on the table for your kids. I don't want to minimize those experiences and say, you know, no, you can just go ahead and hire a nanny and a chef, right? Like, that's obviously not the case. But there are always things we do have control over that can help us lower the overall load and decrease the likelihood of experiencing overwhelm, however it is that we experience it as individuals. And it's truthfully different for everyone. And sometimes people don't even realize what they're feeling is overwhelm. They just say, I'm having a stomach ache. And their doctors are looking for, you know, what is causing that stomach ache because they're looking at their stomach. They're not looking at, oh, you are, you know, overeating and you are not getting enough sleep and you are, you know, eating foods that your body doesn't like and whatever it is. But instead they say, okay, here, take this medicine to see if your stomach ache goes away. So what I look to do is to really lower the overall load. And again, I don't need to just focus on the physical because it's often the emotional, right? You ask people, how are you? Like, oh, I'm busy. Right? I mean, it's the busy is the new black. You know, everyone, we're running around like chickens with our heads cut off because it's our culture. It's actually what we do. And we, you know, we don't always have the tools to be able to identify what's most important so we can identify what it is we should and shouldn't be doing so we don't feel overwhelmed.
With all of the patients and clients that you have worked with, how have you seen overwhelm impact their lives?
I see it every day, and a way that it often shows itself to me, I should say, is when I'm asking people to make changes and they say, well, I don't have time to do that. So I'll give you an example. I have a patient I saw the other day. She's lovely. I've been seeing her for years. She has a history of cancer, and she's developed high blood sugar. And she's doing great. She's cancer-free. But what we do know is that when you have high blood sugar, you know, it can increase your risk of inflammation and kind of have other health issues down the line. So we're looking at trying to change her diet. So she's eating less sugar and fewer carbs and more protein. And she's, again, she's resistant to it, which is legitimate, right? People get very attached to what they eat. But one of the things she said was she's having for breakfast a piece of toast and two fried eggs. And I said, well, can you have more protein in the morning by adding some, say, chicken sausage to your eggs and also some vegetables? She said, I don't have time for that. And I said, well, actually, you know, and it's not that she doesn't have time, it's that she feels overwhelmed. So the truth is, you can get pre-cooked sausage and a bag of spinach out of your freezer, and it takes less time. I actually timed it out at my house the next day because I was like, oh, I hope I'm actually correct in this. It takes less time to scramble two eggs and throw in the sausage and spinach and eat it than it takes to wait for two fried eggs to cook. So, and it's not that she didn't have time. It's that she felt overwhelmed by the idea of making a change. And so that's a place that I will first pull on, oh, this person has overwhelm going on. Although truthfully, the way that I define overwhelm is this, you know, I think about stress filling a bucket. So we have a bucket, which is our ability to, you know, is all the stresses we have. And some people are born with little buckets and some people are born with big buckets. It's hard to change the size of your bucket. That's, you know, doing things that increase your resilience can do that. But for the most part, it kind of, you have a tendency, like you have a tendency to big hips or whatever it is. You have a tendency to a certain size bucket. So what happens is all of the stresses in our lives fill that up. And sometimes you have a stress that takes up a huge portion of the bucket. But there are always little tiny things that fill up around that. So, and those small things can be, you know, one of the examples I give in my book is a squeaky drawer, you know, my keyboard tray. Every time I pulled it out, it was like, I went on for, I'm not kidding you, like a year with it doing that. And I, you know, I tried to fix it. It didn't work. And finally, I was like, I'm going to take half an hour to take the thing apart. And I realized what I needed was either a handyman to legit fix it or a new drawer for my desk. And then I went, you know, and every time I opened it, it caused me like, yeah. And so this was adding to my overwhelm, even though it's a stupid little thing. And what I ended up deciding was, oh, I'm not gonna change it. I'm just gonna leave it be. And then it stopped being stressful to me, right? Because I was choosing to say this is something I'm not gonna change. And so we can look at that with all the things in our bucket, which is what we kind of do, which is actually literally what one of the things that I do in this book is help people look at. You know, it can feel also overwhelming to look at all the stresses, but then it's really empowering because you can say, you know what? I can clean my desk and that will take a huge load off for me because that's particularly impactful for me and stressful for me. Or I can, you know, I feel responsible for doing all the laundry, but, you know, legitimately kids can do laundry when they're 9 or 8. And so you can say, I'm going to get some slack for it, but this is something that I can delegate to my kids to do their own laundry, right? And if they want to wear dirty clothes, gross, but cool, you know, whatever that is. So it's, I don't even remember where you started with that question.
Oh, no, you're great because it's how overwhelm impacts our lives. And you've just shown that it's more than surface level. And that's what I love about your book is that it's much deeper than that. There's something much more than the overwhelm. And you begin by saying it's finding your true north. And I really kind of caught on to that. So what is your true north?
So the true north for me is looking at three things. What your values are, how you want to feel, and then kind of what you want to create in your life. What things do you want to see happen? And identifying those things, you're able to then make the choices that line up with that. So I will say that it really varies for me depending on the season. So values tend to be a little bit more stable. But for instance, one of my values is knowledge and, you know, kind of intellectual stimulation. And I can get that in many, many different ways. Another is family, right? So family is very, very important to me. And sometimes those values will conflict. For instance, you know, when I want to go away for a couple of weeks and I'm leaving my husband with my 12-year-old, but sometimes what I'll do is I'll take everyone with me and I can kind of combine those things. So, you know, those are some of my values. I know that I want to feel, you know, a lot of times people say, well, everyone wants to be happy, but actually happy is so many different things. One person wants to feel like ebullient, like very like bouncy and, you know, effervescent. And another person wants to feel content. And those are different kinds of happy. And so for me, I'm more, you know, I don't particularly want to feel either of those things. You know, if I feel really content, I don't feel driven. And being driven and making change, you know, affecting change is another one of my values, affecting change in the world through what I do. And so if I am feeling content with everything, I actually get more complacent. And that's just for, you know, that's for me in my life, how I function. And so what I want to do is shift gears a little bit and say, okay, I want to feel accomplished, right? Whereas for someone else, they couldn't care less about that, right? So those are a couple of the things, but what I will, again, I redo the exercises that I put forth in this book every quarter. And it really does change, you know, I mean, it's not literally by the season, but it really does change by the season.
Well, and I love it in your book, which all of you are going to want to pick up your own copy of, if I can get it to pop up here, Overwhelm, Overcoming Overwhelm, Dismantle Your Stress from the Inside Out. It's one that you're going to cling to. And you know, Dr. Samantha, in your book, you have it broken down into chapters, but there's exercises. And when we're talking about this true north, you actually walk someone through it. So it's not just like this figment that you write about and then you're like, okay, goodbye. I'm just going to shut the door and you're not going to know what your true north is. You can actually experience it for yourself.
First part of the book is getting very clear about your true north. And then the second part is looking, well, you know, kind of laying the foundation and the understanding and then looking at what your own true north is and then looking at the accumulation of stress in your life in the different areas. So we look at environmental stress and relationship stress and nutritional stress. So you can get an idea of what kinds of things might be impacting you. And then you literally go through and look at what your stresses are and then decide which things you're going to change and what you're not, because you can't do everything ever, right? You can never do everything. And so it's, you know, what are the most important things that are going to have the most impact or the least effort in your life? So you then make more room, and the more room you have, the more change you can make and the more things don't stress you out and make you feel overwhelmed. So it really, it's a step-by-step, very clear process to get you from point A to point B, which is overwhelmed and not overwhelmed.
Yeah, and we don't want anybody to feel overwhelmed by any means when they go through this book, and I don't think they will. I mean, I read the book, and it is a step-by-step process. Now, I've got to think, though, that there's some commonalities when it comes to the world and how we live and looking here within the U.S., specifically North America. What do you feel are kind of the hang-ups that people have when it comes to overwhelm in their life? Like, where does it seem to manifest itself more so than other areas?
That's a really interesting question. So, you know, there's kind of where does it come from and then how does it manifest? And so I would say that one of the big issues in our culture is not having the kind of support that we would need, and whether that's from not living with family. I mean, there's no time in history that you had a crying kid that you wouldn't just hand it to another kid and send it out the door, right? It hurt him, you know. So, for instance, I live in Portland in the city, and I make an effort to say to my kid, get out of the house, go run down the street and find some other children to play with, which is what happened when we were little. But a lot of times now, parents are concerned for kids' safety, and they may live somewhere where there aren't other kids, or, you know, things that are, you know, we would normally share the burden. We would share the burden of taking care of kids. We share the burden of cooking for the community, you know, and we are very, you know, our culture is very insular, which is not bad. It just is what it is. And so, you know, we cook all the food for our family. You know, we handle all of the things for our, you know, family unit. And there's very little, there are very little, you know, very few places in the world where we're actually sharing burden. So I think that's kind of a cultural thing that we have. Another is the food that we eat. I think that often, even when people think they're eating healthy diets, they're really not, because they're saying, well, everyone else eats this. It seems really normal. But, you know, again, when in history did we eat food out of boxes or packages or plastic? Never.
Come right? on, Twinkies aren't good for me?
I actually usually use the example of Ding Dongs. But that said, you know, what I say to my patients is, I don't care, you know, I care about you. I don't care what you do, you know, and for my clients, like, if you want to eat a box of Ding Dongs, just make sure it's in line with your own values, right? If it's cool with you to do that and what the outcome is, fine, eat a box of Ding Dongs. It's your life. You get to do what you want. But the problem is when we start making choices that aren't, you know, aren't really lined up with what's most important to us. So I would say the community part, the food part, and then just the busy part, right? Where one of the things I recommend that people do in the book is actually schedule time to do nothing. And when you have that time in your schedule, you can choose to read, or you can just go for a walk, or you can choose to do nothing. But we don't have downtime. And, you know, even, you know, for me, I always say, you know, there's this kind of paradigm that we see online in the self-help community where people see this kind of anti-busy thing, which I totally understand. So the problem is for people who really like to do a lot of things and be busy and are driven. Like, that's part of my personality, but it doesn't mean that I don't need some downtime. So something's got to give somewhere. And whatever that is for me on any given day is going to be what it is on any given day. But making sure, you know, I think that the fact that we go from thing to thing to thing and don't allow our minds to rest, and it could be just knee jerk going to your phone and, you know, messing around on whatever distracting apps you have. I actually do a weekly challenge with my Facebook group and on Instagram. And this week it's take your three most distracting apps off your phone. Because we really you know, what that does, and not that there's a problem with using whatever your distracting apps are, but because it's okay to do that. But when it's distracting you from being in the moment and feeling your feelings and getting done what you need to get done, then it becomes problematic, right? So those are the, I would say those are the, you know, those are the three kind of cultural things. And then as far as how it manifests, you know, we in our culture were rife with anxiety and depression and, you know, many different health issues that I think are really, you know, related to not overwhelm in the typical way that we think about it, but overwhelm in the way that I'm talking about it, where this, it's just too much. It's more than your body can handle, period. And again, sometimes we have anxiety because we have a legitimate brain chemistry imbalance, but sometimes we have anxiety because we're drinking coffee and not getting enough sleep and running around from thing to thing and not making choices that line up with our values. You know, I had a client last week that I was talking to who has been suffering with mild depression, not severe, and she chose not to medicate it for an extended period of time. And we've been really working on figuring out, well, what things can we do in addition to your diet and your supplements? And she hated her job, and she was committed. You know, she's like, I've had this job, I don't have another option. She's a nurse, and she was working kind of a weird swing shift, which was really affecting her health as well. And I asked her to really sit down and think about, is it something she could change? Like, I understand she thinks she can't change it, but often we think there are things we can't change. And she gave it some thought and talked to her boss and basically went on contract instead of as an employee. And there have been, you know, there are definitely some issues with that that don't work great, but she now can choose to work 4 days a week instead of 6 days a week. And she can now say, okay, my shift is over. Am I going to work those extra few hours? And it's not even so much that her job changed, but that she's now back in control of it, right? Like, she's making the decisions about what works for her. She's saying, no, this approach doesn't work for me. And really, pretty shortly after she made that decision, everything really shifted. And that doesn't mean that she may not be prone to having dips, but how she felt was profoundly different.
That's awesome, because I think a lot of us see our lives as, well, I have to do this, so you just accept the overwhelm and you continue to live in it and you bask in it and it becomes your sunshine, sort of kind of in a weird way. You don't know how else to really live it. Yet when it goes against your values, you know, it's kind of like living with somebody else's expectations, but you're forfeiting your own values. Hence, in the middle is your overwhelm.
Right, yes. And we don't pay attention to what we really want. I think we often go through life assuming what we want because it's what other people around us want. Mm. And not choosing, you know, one of the other things we talk about is choosing an unconventional life. And that doesn't mean, you know, living in a nudist colony or buying a yurt in Montana. You know, it means living a life that is in alignment with who you are and what you want. And that, and not worrying about what other people think. So when I say unconventional, that's what I mean as well. You know, the other, I was just going to also touch on the, on something that you just said about when we are, you know, have this buildup of things that we feel overwhelmed and we just get used to it. I think that it is really common to just say, all right, this is just my life. I can't do anything about it. But what this book is really about is deciding that, no, you do have some control. And, you know, where are you going to act on it in a way that really works for you? And looking at what things get in your way, right? Like, what roadblocks do you have to making the choices? You know, and that can be something like being a perfectionist. It can be, it can be being a perfectionist. It can be the fact that you don't want to disappoint someone. It can be habits and, you know, ways that your brain has rutted in the past, right? All of those things. So identifying where you may glitch up once you know it is, you know, once you identified what it is that you want.
Mm. That's so important, because we don't identify. And why start off the new year hanging your own life in the balance where it's like, okay, well, I'm not going to be able to reach it, so I'm just going to settle for this because this is what I know.
Right. Or making a resolution, right? So like, I'm going to make a New Year's resolution to lose 20 pounds. Well, like, do you really need to lose 20 pounds? Maybe not, right? Maybe this is just this cultural thing that you've taken on. Maybe what you really need to do is to say, well, what I really want to do this year is to connect more with, you know, my kid or whatever the thing is. And then looking at how do we identify what's really important? And then saying, this is, you know, I instead of doing resolutions, I do themes for the year, right? So my theme for this year is connection. My theme for this year is taking care of my body instead of I'm going to lose 20 pounds or I'm going to go to the gym every day. Because, you know, you can't fail at self-care if you shift the idea of self-care into something about, you know, instead of being an outcome or a thing I'm doing, it's, but this is where I want to head and this is who I want to be. It's much, much better way to frame things, because when we fail, we then say, well, I did try it again, I failed again, and then we turn it in on ourselves. And when we turn it on ourselves, it doesn't do anybody, right? You don't get where you want to go anyway, but now you feel badly about it.
Yeah, and you have more roadblocks and more detours, and then you're back to where you started, and oh my goodness, then you're overwhelmed again.
Right, which is the other point. So that's another point actually that I was going to make a few minutes ago, which is that, you know, I think we're really taught to manage our stress when we feel overwhelmed. So someone's like, you know, go get a manicure, or you should meditate every day. But we can't just add more things on to what we're already doing, because then you end up feeling more overwhelmed, especially if they're challenging things, right? Or especially if they cost money that we don't really have. And so looking to, which is the idea of the book, we want to dismantle it rather than just manage it. Now, of course, you want to manage your stress, right? We need to do things to manage our stress because stress happens. And it's more important to try to get underneath it, figure out how you got there in the first place and what things you can do to lower your load. So then when you do the thing to relieve your stress, it's actually effective and it lasts.
I love it. Well, I know when you write a book, authors, I've spoken to a few handful, no, more than a handful, yeah. But there's this personal connection with the books that they write, whether it's fiction or nonfiction. Where in your life have you experienced overwhelm?
Gosh. So last fall, when I was working on, you know, kind of ramping up for the book launch and the promotion, I had, you know, all in one chunk, a whole bunch of things go off the rails, which happened to me also when I was working on the book proposal. So when I was working on the book proposal, within a period of, you know, 4 months, my father had a stroke and passed away. I came back from the, So my father had a stroke and passed away. I came back, and a day after I got back to the office after being home with my mom and helping take care of her and get things sorted for a couple weeks, my office manager of 4 years told me she took a new job and she was going to be leaving in 2 weeks, and usually I need at least 4 to 6 weeks to get someone trained. Our nanny was leaving, and we had to get, you know, someone else who could transport my kid. I had a talk I was going to give in Utah the next week, and then 2 weeks after that, I was teaching an academy at a pretty large conference in Portland called the World Domination Summit. And so I had like all of these crazy things going off the rails. I had to postpone going out with the proposal, and then I had another batch of stuff in the fall. And then this fall, when I was working on, you know, kind of heading toward the launch, we, you know, ramping up, working with my PR team, working with my publisher, getting everything sorted out for the talk that I would be doing at our local bookstore called Powell's in Portland, and working on, you know, all of these crazy moving bits. I went away because the travel's really important to me. I went to Europe for a couple, like about 10 days with a girlfriend, and I came back, and the next day I walked into the kitchen, and my 12-year-old said, "Don't go in that cabinet." And I said, "Why? Is there something moving? Is there something alive in there?" And my husband said, "Actually, we heard something." And it turned out that Portland, apparently, which I did not know this, has a problem with rats, and we had rats in our house. And so, I cannot even. So, we moved.
Mice are worse enough, Dr. Samantha, but rats,
I had no idea it was a thing in Portland, and I started talking about it, like, oh yeah, I had them last year, or yeah, I had them 2 years ago, or yeah, we have them in our attic right now, and I'm like, seriously? So I hauled everybody, we moved to an Airbnb, so we're living in an Airbnb, I'm traveling, you know, going back and forth to the house for my, you know, podcast interviews, and working on the blogs, and my meetings, and my Skype consults, and then trying to, you know, negotiate that with what's going on at the office, and then my office manager had a health issue that she was out, and I was running the clinic by myself while I was seeing the patients. And so overwhelm happens, right? Like, it happens, and often when it happens big. And because I'm brutal about what I say yes to, about what I take on, about how I approach my life, you know, I get upset and I feel my feelings about it, but it doesn't drown me the way that it used to when I would have, you know, just, I've always done a lot of stuff, right? Like, I always would, when I was in college, I was like in a singing and dancing group, and I was had, you know, a double major, and then I was taking extra credit courses, and, you know, whatever those things were. Like, I'm just someone who does that. But what I've learned over time is that if I want to do that, because that's important to me, I have to keep my overall load down. So, you know, my husband had a friend who was having some trouble in his marriage and wanted to stay with us. And I said, not right, you know, right, I couldn't. I said, you know what, we're dealing with the rodent thing and I have too much on my plate and I will help him in any way that we can, but no. And that's a really hard thing to say no when someone who you care about needs your help. But ultimately, it wouldn't have been okay for me and my family to make a decision that would create a situation where I didn't feel the way I needed to feel in order to be able to do what I need to do to take care of them and my job and my patients and all of that. So, yeah, I've had plenty of overwhelm in my day for sure. You can hear it all ramping up when I talk about it.
Yeah, there goes the blood pressure. It's like, bring it down.
But like at the time, I didn't feel like that. I had moments of upset, but I wasn't kind of ramping up. And that's actually, the blood pressure thing's interesting. So for me, I don't have, like, blood pressure isn't my chip, but I will get reflux, right? Like, so I will start having digestive issues. And as soon as I have that, that's my body's way of saying you're overwhelmed, you know, and I could be like, oh, that's my body's way of saying don't eat any more, you know, spicy food, but that's not what it's saying, right? Yes, the spicy food's triggering it, but the problem is really something else. And the problem is the overwhelm and where do I need to lower my load? Mm.
Did you all hear that? I mean, you just need to listen to her one more time that the whole idea is your body's talking to you, but are you listening? Because it's probably telling you got overwhelmed and you're stuck in it. And listen to the author here, Dr. Samantha. She knows her stuff. She's seen enough of her clients and patients and cared for them. You're going to want to pick up your own copy of Overcoming Overwhelm, Dismantle Your Stress from the Inside Out. Well, for the person who's sitting there, maybe somewhat consumed with overwhelm, rats, children, whatever else, I can't get off of the rat part. That would drive, I mean, think about that. Just your New Year, sitting there like at Christmas time or whatever, however you're celebrating your holidays, and all of a sudden you see a rat comes by. I mean, a mouse you can handle. Oh, it's kind of cute.
If there was a rat coming by, it would have been another story. Like, if that was not the case. It was like a couple of dudes got into the wall. We had to work it out. But, I mean, the whole process took almost 6 weeks. Right? So that was being out of the house,
yeah.
You know, and if I had sat in, like, ruminated on it, it would have put me over the edge. But I was like, okay, this is what we've got. I'm not staying in the house. And my husband's all like, we could just stay there. They can't get into the, you know, like, he buttoned it up so they couldn't get into the living area. Right? Like, once, but I'm like, no, I didn't. I'm not.
Well, for that person who is kind of sitting in that overwhelm right now, what would you tell her, and kind of the first step is to overcoming that overwhelm?
That's a really great question. So the first step I would say is to get really clear about what's most important and how you want to feel. Because if you have that at your fingertips, it allows you to make decisions in a different way. You're not knee-jerk making decisions. And then one of the things about being overwhelmed is it's very hard to know where to start, right? And so by really knowing what's most important, how you want to feel, and then looking at what you've got, you can choose the things that are easiest to do. Like, don't choose the giant, you know, don't choose reorganizing your garage if you're feeling overwhelmed, right? Choose reorganizing your desk drawer, or choose, you know, if you can afford it, choose to get someone to help clean your house once a month, or, you know, choose to do a childcare trade with a friend. Who can, you know, so you have a little bit of time to breathe. So choosing the things that allow a little bit more space, and the small things first, because when you try to do the big things when you're overwhelmed, then you end up in that position where you feel like you're failing. And so the little things first, because every little thing makes a difference. And if you do a lot of little things, you have this accumulation. That actually, there's one idea that I have that might, you know, one of the tips I give in the book is called a to-do. So what I always say is, your stress and your overwhelm isn't about your to-do list. However, when you have this giant to-do list, it can feel really daunting and overwhelming, and you feel like you're never getting out from under it. So what I have people do is make what's called a to-do hit list. And so you go to your to-do list, and you make a list of any of the tasks that will take less than, say, 10 minutes. And then you schedule time, even if it's like on the weekend for an hour or two, or if you can do every day for half an hour, and start knocking out those things one at a time. then your list just goes, and it gives you kind of a feeling of breathing room, even though you haven't made major changes. So that's kind of a little tip, great way to start. But the big tip is going to be understand what's most important, and then the little things that are going to be the best bang for your buck first. Mm.
Well, you talk about change, and change is challenging. You know that. And you write about talking about things that you can change, things you can't change, and things you won't change or you just don't change. How do you know what to change?
Yeah, so the third category, I call it things you're choosing not to change, right? And it doesn't mean you're choosing to never change them. It means you're choosing not to change them right now. So the drawer, for instance, that thing was one of the things that I chose not to change, right? Because you're taking control back. So the way to choose that is really, you know, it's a little bit of a bigger picture. It's hard to know just to pick one thing without any context of what do I want to change. It goes back once again to what's most important. And is it something that's stressing you out a lot? And how much effort is it going to take to change it? So sometimes it is a big thing, like, you know, someone who's has a communication issue with their husband and it's causing a lot of stress in the home. You know, it really, that's the thing that's going to, if all the other things you're going to do aren't going to be enough to balance out the amount of stress that's causing, then that's something you have to change. I call those non-negotiables, right? So there are sometimes things that are non-negotiables, and it could be something like, you know, when I eat gluten, for instance, just because that's all the rage right now, right? So when I eat gluten, I get bloated and tired and angry, and I know that when I eat it, that happens, yet the person keeps eating it. So it may be that that's one of the changes that is important to make rather than to say I'm not going to change it. And that said, if it's something that you really, really don't have the time and bandwidth to change, you put it in that pile for now. You say, this is not something I'm going to change right now. And then that gives you the grace, is kind of the word that I want to use, to be able to then work on the things that you do have the bandwidth to change. And ultimately, you'll be able to get to those things. So kind of finding the place of where it is is it the non-negotiable thing? And again, even sometimes non-negotiable things we need to pause on. So it's really about getting, again, keep coming back to this thing about being clear about how you want to feel and what's most important, and then using that, like I even have people write it on a little index card to actually vet what choices and what things are going to do. So let's say you make this New Year's resolution that you want to lose 20 pounds. I keep pulling that up because everybody has that New Year's resolution so often. You know, you got to look at your list and how do I want to feel? And so that's going to cause you a ton of stress, whether it's emotional stress or logistical stress, maybe that's not, and you're going to feel not good, and it doesn't line up with what's most important because you're putting all this effort into that instead of the things that are important, you know, maybe that's something that for the time being isn't something you should be choosing. Or it may be that it is something that's important, but you need to make sure that you have the right things in place to make sure that you can move forward with it and be successful, whether that's accountability or seeing a naturopath or a nutritionist or someone who's properly trained in helping figure out what you need to eat so you're not on a diet which never works, you know, or whatever the thing is, to make sure that you have set up what you need, whether that's a mindset thing or a logistical thing. Sometimes it's really about, you know, and sometimes it's about your history, right? So sometimes people, back to the food thing, people will overeat because they, you know, don't feel like they're worthy, they don't feel like they're worthy, or they had a parent who was shaming them for eating when they were a kid, or they are carrying more fat in their bodies, and we live in a culture where that's judged horribly. And so, you know, so there's a psychological thing that needs to be dealt with first. Like, I'm okay with who I, you know, before you go on a diet and lose 20 pounds, to say, I am okay with who I am. My fat is part of my body. It's, you know, you're not, you know, we always say, like, you know, I saw a meme about this a long time ago where, you know, people say you are fat because you have fat, but they don't say you are fingernails or you are hair, right? It's this weird thing in our culture. It's bizarre. And sometimes, you know, before you're going to be able to move forward with a change, you need to deal with the issues underneath that are keeping you from really moving forward with whatever the change is that you need to make.
That is powerful. And we need to do that. And what better time than to start with a new theme, not a New Year's resolution. Think of a solution because you're going from stress to solution. That's in the book. You got to read about it. We're not going to give him that information. We got to give a little bit of a carrot dangle here.
I will say the main thing about the book is it takes you step by step through all of this. So it takes you step by step of figuring out what your values are, how you want to feel, what's most important, what your stresses are, and what you're going to do. And then you end up with literally a list of here are the things I'm going to address. Like that's, it literally takes you from point A to point B. Mm-hmm.
So. Well, we're going to go to point C. So okay. for those who have children or maybe even husbands that like gaming, you talk about a story that your son and your husband are playing. I think it's a Star Wars Battlefront.
Yes.
And it's this whole thing about this virtual world. How do you find balance between the virtual world and reality?
Yeah, you know, so that happens with gaming and videos, but it also happens with movies and books and your own, you know, fantasy island inside your head. So that's something that I think is really common to struggle with, right? Because there's nothing wrong with video games, right? But sometimes the world that it creates, your subconscious can't really tell the difference between watching, I assume this, right? My assumption is that your subconscious is very simple, right? And so it sees shooting and it thinks shooting, and then, you know, there's this kind of place where it will then, you know, I remember another video story from when I was little. My kid was watching the Ninja Turtles when he was like three. And so he was watching the Ninja Turtles and I turned it off. And you know, often kids will lose it when you turn their TV off or whatever. He like legit hauled out and punched me. And I went, you know, we dealt with it. And you know, what I said was, this created an atmosphere in his head and in his world that made him think it's okay to punch his mother, which, by the way, we've been very clear very quickly that was not okay. So we said no violent videos because we don't want it doing that to your subconscious. Now, if a kid's a teenager or someone's an adult, they're going to be making that choice. So, you know, what I will say is just to make sure to balance out that time with doing nothing, with reading, with getting into nature, with doing what our bodies are meant to do. So let's say that's a stress, right? Like the video, the gaming, let's say ultimately there's the screen is a stress, the energy, anytime you're most games, you're creating this adrenaline, and you're not supposed to feel adrenaline on the regular, right? You're supposed to feel adrenaline when cheetah's going to eat your baby at the watering hole. You're not supposed to feel it all day long. And so it really means, first of all, making sure you're limiting time. So and again, it's not just about that it's a video on principle. It's about what it's creating in your body. And then that you're balancing that out in a way that you can really help your central nervous system and decrease your other stresses. So as weird as it sounds, when you're eating a healthy diet and making sure you're getting plenty of alone time if you're an introvert and going for walks and doing things that match up with your own values, it's going to be less negatively impactful when you make choices to do things that, you know, may create an imbalance of some sort in your chemistry or in your brain or any of that, right? So the more you can lower your overall load, the less of an impact one thing will have.
Hmm. Well, you know, how much do you believe, talking about virtual world, I kind of hint the idea that social media can be a virtual world for us. We live vicariously through everybody else's highlight reels, and oh my gosh, they just went like, you're traveling. If I looked at yours, oh my gosh, she's in Jamaica, now she's in Germany, now she's in London. Why can't I be everywhere that she is? And we begin to, you know, want, whether it's jealousy, whatever it is that comes into it. How much do you believe social media affects our barometer when it comes to overwhelm?
Really interesting. You know, I really think it depends on the person, right? It depends on the feelings that you get when you're on social media. So I personally noticed that there are some places that I hang out that on social. So I'm going to get, I actually get a lot of needs met on social media because of one of the things that I do to kind of be brutal about my time is I really don't schedule a lot of time in person with people, but I have a lot of friends that I really want to keep in touch with. So I don't think there's, you know, I personally don't have feel like that's a bad thing because it really works for me. But I have noticed that there are certain places, certain, you know, so I have my brick and mortar business where I see patients and then I see clients online. And so I'm kind of part of this entrepreneur online world. And there are certain spaces where I will feel jealous. And when I'm seeing that, I go, I don't need to compare myself to these people. It's nuts. And I'm going to just remove myself from that situation. So usually what I'll try to do is just go elsewhere. But if you're someone who really feels you're really getting jealous, you're really feeling like you're less than, your life isn't good, I always say, like, everything online is curated, and sometimes it's curated to make you feel badly, sometimes it's curated to make you feel jealous, sometimes it's curated, you know, because people are insecure, whatever it is. So to be able to acknowledge when it's triggering for you, and if you're someone that really feels like that on social, social isn't a place for you. It's not in alignment with what your values are, because you don't want to, and how you want to feel, because you don't want to feel like that. So if there's a way to be online and make a shift, whether it's, you know, and sometimes it's going to therapy and dealing with the fact that you feel unworthy and less than, because then you look at those people and you don't feel badly. So sometimes it's really about getting underneath it, but sometimes it's just about changing what you're doing and where you are. But I always look at any time something is triggering to you emotionally to look at, okay, why is this happening? What is it actually triggering? And is that something that I can look at that will help me change my life and live a life that makes me feel better, that makes me feel good about who I am? And, you know, I mean, online is curated, period. And I'm, you know, I personally try to make an effort to talk about the hard things too, and to talk about my struggles as well, because I think that's really, it's an important part of who I am. And I really don't think that it's good for women in general to be living in this curated world all the time. You know, we'd see that with magazines in the, you know, 80s and 90s, but now it's constant because we go to social when we would normally just be walking somewhere or waiting in line, or, you know, it's an inundation in a way that we historically have not had it. And so being, you know, I think self-awareness is the real key, is going to be the answer I'm going to give you there. Being aware of the things that make you feel not great on social, but also actually everywhere. And that could be a person too, right? Like if it's a person that makes you feel not good, you need to look at why. Are you feeling insecure and it's your issue, or is this someone really being demeaning and unkind to you and it's not someone you should be spending time with? You know, even if it's a family member, you can say, wow, this isn't healthy for me. And you can say, when you say, you know, when you comment on my looks or my weight, it makes me feel less than, and it makes me feel hurt, and I would really like to ask you to not do that anymore. So
I think that's something we all need to kind of take to heart with this new year happening. There's so many things out there. And I think as women, especially our men too, but the women were out there and we can be really mean, honestly, women can be. And I think we kind of need to take a step back and say, what is my purpose in being online? Is it really helping me or is it causing a trigger? So I love that you say that. Well, in writing your book, you dedicated your book at the very beginning to your dad, and it says a quote, "I never told you life would be easy." What hope would you give to those who are drowning in overwhelm?
Yeah, you know, what I would say is life isn't easy, and it is complicated, and you're always going to have more stress, and to not put off having the life you want, because there's always going to be something else kind of coming your way, whether that's, you know, family stress or financial stress or world stress or, you know, whatever that is, there's always going to be something. So get clear about what's most important to you so you can create a life that lines up with what you really want. And it's not always easy, and it sometimes takes time to undo, but ultimately that, you know, to be able to be okay with the fact that life isn't always easy, but to still be living a life that lines up with who you are and what your values are.
Mm. Well, I know people are going to want to connect with you, Dr. Samantha. Where can they find you?
Yeah, so my website is drsamantha.com, drsamantha.com, and the book is available at drsamantha.com/overcomingoverwhelm. And you can find me on social, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, pretty much Instagram at Dr. Samantha ND. So @DrSamanthaN is in Nancy D. So for naturopathic doctor, I'm on the socials there. And you can find me there whenever I don't need to take a break and rest to keep my overwhelm down.
That's right. You got to take your own advice. You wrote a book on it, and I know all of you are going to want to pick up your own copy of Overcoming Overwhelm. We will have all of that information in the show notes to you, so it's easily and readily accessible to you. Well, Dr. Samantha, before I let you go, I have one final question.
Yes.
The series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
Oh, my goodness. So much. You know, I would say that going through what I've been through has allowed me to get clear about what it is that I want to do, who I want to be, and what I can do on this planet to make a difference. And there have been some very difficult things in my past, and I hate to say, well, I'm glad those things happened, because of course I'm not. But I will say that there is a learning that you can get from everything that happens, and that when I look at where I've been and how I've gotten to be who I am and where I am, that it was, I don't regret a thing for a minute. My story is me. My story is who I am.
And you're beautiful, Dr. Samantha. Thank you so much for your time. I cannot wait to have you back.
I look forward to it. Thanks so much for having me.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.